everybody feeling today? Awake? We moving yet? All right, there we go. Well, man, I'm so excited. This morning we are going to bring this series we've been in for the last month to a close. But before we do that, I want to make you aware of something that is important, is that next Sunday is Sabbath Sunday. Now, if you remember all the way back to the beginning of the year, we went through this series called How We Change. And if we follow Jesus, our goal should be to become more like Jesus. And part of that is not just wishing and hoping and praying that one day we magically wake up and all of a sudden we're living lives like Jesus, but that there's actually certain spiritual practices that we want to put into place in our lives. We want to do the things that Jesus did. And as we do those, we'll start to look more like him. And so we've talked about prayer and fasting, scripture reading, silence and solitude, confession. You guys remember going through all that? And see, our heart here at Bridgepoint is that if this is your church family, that you would go and you would pick two of those things that we talked about and implement them into your life. In fact, each Sunday during our response time, we actually go back to those different things where we can go ahead and start to put that into practice. But Sabbath is one that you can't really do for like 3 minutes at the end of a service. That's a day that you take with your family and your friends to relax, to worship. And so next Sunday, we're having Sabbath Sunday. We want you for that whole day, spend it with family and friends. We're not going to have services here, but I hope you have a service in your living room or around the dinner table. Read scripture as a family, pray together, worship together, whatever that looks like for you guys. Enjoy that next Sunday, and we'll see you back here 2 weeks from today. Sound good? All right. Well, this morning, we are wrapping up this series we've been in called The Generous Life. And the whole idea is that as we grow and mature as people, our focus should shift away from ourselves and onto other people. In fact, I was talking to one of my kids about this last night, and I was telling him, you know, he didn't want to do something he was supposed to do. And I said, listen, I don't want to clean up the kitchen. You know, there's certain things that I don't want to do. I said, I don't want to wake up early tomorrow to get ready for church. And he said, well, didn't you choose to be a pastor? And I was like, well, fair point on that one. But I was telling him that when you're a baby, you know, the whole world revolves around you. But as you grow and mature, you have to start to think about other people and you want to contribute to the family. And in the same way with our spiritual growth, we start off as spiritual infants and children, and we'll follow Jesus and we'll do what he's asked us to do as long as it's on our timetable or we're comfortable with it. If it doesn't make me, have to go reevaluate some things, if I don't get challenged, then I'm okay. But as we grow and mature, the focus should be less on ourselves and more on God and on how we can help other people find life in Jesus and grow to spiritual maturity in him. And one of the ways that this happens is through generosity. That's kind of our tagline for this series, that generosity is not God's fundraising plan, it's his family raising plan. Because when you start to give of your time, your efforts, your money, what you're doing is you're saying, I'm going to take this stuff that I could keep for myself, and instead I'm going to use it to bless other people. And so we've talked about generosity, certainly financially. We talked about generosity through living a life of simplicity. And that some of us, it's hard to be generous when we have so much stuff that we have to maintain. Lastly, we talked about generosity through hospitality and even opening our homes to other people. But this week, we're going to take a little bit different approach. Because this week, I want to talk about what it looks like to be a generous church. Because yes, generosity changes us, but God also uses generosity to change the world. So yes, generosity does a work in us, but then through that, God wants to do a work through us as well. And I think that for many of us, this starts to make more sense when you start to understand the story the Bible is telling. Because many of us, maybe we grew up and we think that the story the Bible's telling is that we're all sinners, and because of that, God is angry, he's mad at us, and he wants to punish us by sending us to hell. But then he sent his son to die for us, to absorb God's wrath, and if we believe in him, then we get to go to heaven when we die. And there are parts of that story that are definitely true, but the story the Bible is telling is so much bigger and grander than that. And so some of this may be recap, but I want to present this to you a little bit differently than we have in the past. I want us to think about the Bible as like a six-act story. Have you guys ever been to a one-act play or, you know, kind of three-act structures? The Bible, we could say, has six different acts, and I just want to walk through those quickly with you. The first one, Act 1, would be creation. And by the way, if you're taking notes, this is a great way to kind of remember the overall arc and story the Bible's telling. Because the Bible starts off with creation. Genesis chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Now the earth was formless and empty. Darkness covered the surface of the watery depths, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the surface of the waters. So in creation, we get this picture that everything is formless and void. One translation says wild and waste. And the Spirit is hovering over the waters, which in ancient Near East culture always symbolized chaos. So what God is doing is he's bringing order to the chaos. He's separating light from dark, the land from the sea, the ground from the sky, and then he's populating all those areas. And part of what he does in creation is he carves out a little bit of space that he puts a garden in. The garden's called Eden, and this really is heaven on earth. It's where heaven and earth come together. Adam and Eve are put there. They have perfect relationship with one another, right? They're naked and not ashamed. They have nothing to hide from each other. They have perfect relationship with God. They get to have an intimate relationship with him. They even have perfect relationship with creation. But they were given actually a task. Some of us think that work is like the result of sin, but no. Even before sin entered into the world, Adam and Eve were given a task. They were told to be fruitful and multiply, and then to subdue the earth. So their task was to continue God's work of bringing order to the chaos. And so in that way, we could say that Adam and Eve were told to enjoy heaven on earth, but also to expand heaven on earth. Are we tracking so far? That's act one is creation. And I wish that that's where the story ended, because that would be a pretty good world to live in. But act two is called the fall. And this is where, if you're familiar with the story, in Eden there was a river, and then there's two trees on either side of the river. There's the tree of life that Adam and Eve could eat and live forever. But then there was the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And God said, don't eat from that tree. I want you to trust me to decide what's good and evil, what's right and what's wrong. And sometimes people say, why would God even give them the choice? See, God wants a relationship with us. And in a relationship, you have to choose. He wasn't looking for robots to just do whatever he wanted. He wanted people who would choose him. And so they're presented with this choice. And you know the choice Adam and Eve made. It's the same choice that all of us make at certain times in our lives, that we want to be king of our own lives. We want to decide what's right and what's wrong. And when Adam and Eve eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, sin and death are unleashed into the world. Like all that chaos that God was bringing order to, it's now unleashed even in God's good creation. And so heaven and earth kind of break apart. Now at this point, this is where a lot of us think, okay, well, from this point on, God's just giving up on the earth and he's just going to try to save as many people, get them into heaven before the end of the world. But that's not the story the Bible's painting. God doesn't give up on his project 2 pages into the story. No, he still has a plan to bring heaven to earth. And in Act 3, he does this through the nation of Israel. So God calls a people for himself that becomes the nation of Israel. And they are supposed to do exactly what Adam and Eve were supposed to do. They're supposed to embody heaven on earth. They want to show the world what heaven on earth looks like. This is why they do strange things, like God didn't want them to have a king. He didn't want them to have an army. He didn't want them to amass a bunch of wealth, because he wanted them to trust him to be their leader, their protector, their provider. They were supposed to be a light to the world, show them what heaven on earth looks like, and then the nations would come to the light. They would expand heaven on earth. But just like Adam and Eve, Israel fails in this mission. And for hundreds of years, they turn their back on God. They won't come back to him regardless of the prophets that he sends. And so God says, I'm not going to force myself on you. He removes his protection, and Israel is conquered by their enemies. And so the Old Testament ends with God's people asking, is heaven ever going to come to earth? Is God going to fulfill his promises? Will he bring his kingdom back? And the prophets come, and the answer is resounding yes, which brings us to Act 4, which is the act defined by Jesus. Now, when Jesus shows up on the scene, it says actually in Luke that he came to preach the good news of the kingdom. He actually said, this is why I was sent. He doesn't say I was sent to die, but he says that's part of it, but I'm sent to tell you that God's kingdom is here. Heaven is coming to earth. And so when Jesus goes around and he's performing these miracles, they're not just, you know, magic tricks. They're not just to prove his divinity. He's actually reversing the effects of what Adam and Eve unleashed into the world, Right? He goes around, he forgives people of their sin. He raises people from the dead. He gives blind people their sight. And he says, this is going to be good news to people who are poor, who are oppressed, who are wounded. And what thanks does Jesus get for bringing heaven to earth? Well, the political and religious elite conspire together. They bring Jesus up on false charges. He's wrongly convicted, and they murder him. And for a few days, it seems like, you know what? I guess this is just the way the world is always going to be. Maybe heaven really isn't ever going to come to earth. But 3 days later, Jesus rose from the dead. And because of his resurrection, we know that sin and death don't get the final word. Sin and death aren't going to wreak havoc forever, but Jesus overcame sin and death. He struck the decisive blow on that day, and we can trust that one day he will complete his work of bringing heaven to earth. And yes, everyone who believes in him, we have the promise that just like Jesus was resurrected, one day we will be resurrected to enjoy that. Are we tracking so far? Now, I want to skip ahead then. We're going to skip to Act 6. Which is new creation. And I'll explain why I'm skipping to Act 6 in just a moment. So we know how the story of the Bible begins, right? There's a garden with a river and there's two trees. And then how does the Bible end? Revelation chapter 21, verse 1. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away and the sea was no more. I love that because at the beginning there's the watery depths that the Spirit's hovering over. There's all of this chaos. And it says that one day, Jesus is going to have a new heaven, new earth. There will be no more chaos. There will be no more disorder. In the subsequent verses, there will be no more tears. There will be no more death. God is going to make all things new. By the way, that word new there in the Greek, there's two Greek words for new. One is naos, which means it's like brand new. It's just something that wasn't there before, and now it's here. But then there's another Greek word. The word is kainos, which just means like it's renewed or renovated. It was something that was old that has been fixed up and been made like new. And that's the word that the author of Revelation uses, that Jesus is going to rescue, restore, and redeem this world. That's how the story ends. So it's important to know that's how the story ends because Act 5 is actually defined by the church. And that's important because that's the role that you and I play. So if you think about we're in a six-act play, we're in Act 5, and we know how it ends. But from now until then, there's a little bit of improv that we have to do. Right? We know Jesus is making all things new. He's bringing heaven to earth. And so he's given the church the same task as Adam and Eve, the same task as Israel, the same task that Jesus came to do, which is to embody heaven on earth and to expand heaven on earth. See, I think when we realize that, we realize that, man, there's so much more than just about going to heaven when we die. That's a gospel that's very much focused on me. It's very, very self-centered. It's very immature understanding of following Jesus. But when we understand that we now have a purpose to bring heaven to earth, then that means that everything we do, including through generosity, that's the aim of our life. And so as a church, we want to be people who, when we see things in this world that are chaotic, that are disordered, when we see people who are hungry, people who are homeless, we see people who are hurting, we have the responsibility from Jesus himself to bring heaven to those situations. Does that make sense? Yes, no, maybe. I feel like I know you're like drinking from a fire hose here. But I say all that to say this morning, I want to highlight three different global ministry partners that we have here at Bridgepoint that are actively bringing heaven to earth literally all across the world. And really, the reason I want to highlight these ministries is twofold. Number one, if you're giving financially here at Bridgepoint, I want you to know where your money is going and the difference that it's making. But number two, my hope is that this would spark a curiosity or a passion in you so that when you leave here, it's not simply that I'm giving money over to this organization. It's not about patting ourselves on the back. But hopefully we have an awareness today that motivates us to an action tomorrow. So the first ministry partner that I want to talk about is actually our longest global ministry partner here at Bridgepoint, and that's Destino Del Reino. Now, you've probably heard me talk about them before, but this is a children's home and school in Siguatepeque, Honduras. And full disclosure, this was started by my aunt-in-law, so it's my wife's aunt. And she felt years ago, God called her to move to Honduras. Didn't know what she was going to do, didn't know where she was going to live, but she moved to Honduras. Didn't even speak Spanish at the time. But then as she kind of got settled in and accustomed to the culture, she felt like God was telling her to start this school for the poorest of the poor. And so the way it started, the first year, they just had kindergarten. And then the next year, they did kindergarten and first grade. And then the next year, kindergarten, first, and second. To where we are today is they have a full kindergarten, K through 12 school. And it's known as one of the nicest schools in the area. I mean, there are kids who are like 6 years old who are like fluent in both Spanish and English because of their involvement with Destino Del Reino. And what makes this even more unique is that you can only go to this school if you are among the poorest of the poor. Like, you can't buy your way into this school. Like, the kids that go to this school, sometimes the only food that they have, the only clothes that they have, the only way out of their homes through transportation is done through this school. And I love Rhonda's heart behind this school, because she's not just educating people, although that's certainly part of it. She wants to educate them so they can have an upwardly mobile life where they can get out of, I mean, some of the houses they live in are just like, you know, a cinder block as big as this rug up here, just a rectangular building. But she's also training them intentionally that as they leave the school, they leave with a missionary mindset, which I think is fascinating. And it's also convicting because, you know, we tend to think, oh yeah, we're going to send missionaries to other countries. She's training up people who are being sent out as missionaries all over the world, including here to the United States. And I just love her heart and her passion. In fact, as the school has grown, she's also taken in kids into her own family. So she's become a mom to dozens of kids over the years. Some of them are grown and have their own kids now. And man, I love that we have been able to send teams over to Honduras to partner with Destino. And our hope is that we're going to be able to send more partners and more people over there in the future. And so when we give, that money goes straight to providing these kids food, clothing, and education. That money is going to help these children right here as they kind of grow and develop. Now, that is our longest global partner, but I want to introduce you now to our newest global partner. I'm going to introduce you to Brandon Smith with No Hungry Children. And so would you guys put your hands together and give him a warm Bridgepoint welcome?
Step off the stage for me, I guess. Awesome. Go ahead and run that
video real quick. Y'all check this out real quick.
Yeah, it's crazy because they are the most joyful kids that you would ever meet. But yet, the need is so desperate. During the lunch hour, and this school was not getting fed, and half the kids weren't there, the other half had their heads on their desk, and I said, where are all the kids? And they said they've left to go to try to find food. Walking through the slums for the first time was a life-changing experience. If you can imagine hundreds of thousands of people and no sewage, no running water, really. Obviously, no toilets or sanitation. A huge percentage of the population is children under 15. Slavery is a huge issue. Kids getting sold into slavery by their parents or not having parents. Just kids everywhere on top of each other. We figured out very quickly that you could feed a child for $1 a week, that they would get two meals a day. The opportunity was there to make a huge impact with very little money. If I could say one thing to someone who was considering partnering with No Hungry Children, it would be just do something. There's so many opportunities to get involved with our ministry, with somebody else's ministry. Find out what God is already doing and get involved with that. If you're not sure what to do, just go where God is already at work. And I can tell you, God is at work in No Hungry Children.
It took me about 100 times watching that video to not just be in tears, unable to speak after I can watch that video. Just it brings it all back. Kenya is my second home. Love being there. Miss the kids there. I got to go there for the first time in 2006. That's where I met Maurice Odhiambo, the founder of Mana Missions. He lived for 8 years in the slums, got married when he was in the slums, had his first two kids in the slums. And he invited us. I met him at a pastor's conference, and he invited us in 2010 to come and see where he lived and what he was trying to do to go in and serve the kids in that community. And so in 2010, my wife and I, my business partner, my sister got to go tour the slums for the first time. And when I saw the kids, we just started giving our own money, just started telling people about this opportunity. You can give them porridge in the morning, rice and beans in the afternoon. We buy food by the month in massive 200-pound bags of beans, big bags of rice. You can't carry, the Kenyans can carry it. I can't carry it. But, so we buy massive bulk in order to get the price down per meal. And so it averages out to 10 cents a meal. So they get two meals a day, 5 days a week in school, for $1. And you guys, so go ahead and, let's keep going. So obviously we all want our life to count for something, right? That's why I talked about at the end of the video, just get involved in something. If you're not doing anything to build God's kingdom, do something. You don't have to make something up. Just go do whatever God's already doing. Get involved in it. And I know this church has some amazing partnerships and amazing opportunities for you to do that. And we're so thankful that you guys have partnered with us. But impact is making the most impact. I don't know of any ministry that can have such an impact with so very little for a dollar a week. Go ahead. So this is just a little bit of history. 2011, the ministry started, and since then we've served over 9.45 million meals, and we're currently feeding over 4,000 children every day in school in 36 schools. We'll actually hit 10 million in September or October of this year. It's going to be an awesome celebrating time. We don't just feed the kids physically. They get fed mentally, emotionally, and spiritually as well. When we add a school to our feeding program, children just start coming that used to not go to school. And so when they start coming to school, they don't just get fed physically. They get fed mentally, emotionally, and spiritually as well. We actually have chaplains that go into the schools and minister to the children each week. Just some facts about the slums. There's over 2.5 million people in Nairobi. 60% of the population live within a 6% land mass. There's over 100 slums in Nairobi. The one that you saw the most there, Kibera, is the largest slum. It's estimated that there are upwards of close to a million people within one square mile in that location. Sorry, I got ahead of myself there. So going into 2022, at the end of 2021, we had several schools on our waiting list that were not getting fed. And these are a list of some of those. And then Matt messaged me and said, hey, how can we help? We've raised some money here at the end of the year through our giving campaign, and we want to be a part of what you're doing. And so go on. And so St. Priscar, actually, you can go back to the last one. So we scratched St. Priscar off the list, and you guys sponsored St. Priscar School. And they have 128 children, and you guys have been providing almost 1,300 meals a week to those 128 children. You've provided over 33,000 meals in the first 6 months of this year. Praise the Lord. Amen. So that's having an impact in a massive way. So there's a picture of your school. It's a little dark in the back. Sorry, the technology there. Sometimes when we have to ask them to take pictures, they don't come in quite as well as when we take them ourselves. Tried to get them in the light, and it didn't help very much. We have some ministry goals. We're a very small organization, grassroots organization. We don't have a big staff. We don't spend a lot of money. 100% of the money that Bridgepoint is giving goes to buy food for those kids. It doesn't go to do any marketing. It doesn't go to any salaries. It doesn't go to any travel. It's 100% going to buy food. And that's the commitment that we have to all of our public donors. They come through the website. They say, hey, we want to sponsor a school. 100% of their money goes to that school, goes to buy food. So we do have some ministry expenses, though, that we are trying to raise money for separately. We have to raise that privately, and we're about $1,500 a month short right now with marketing that we're doing and some different fundraising for bringing staff on and stuff like that. We do have over 1,000 children on our waiting list. I know you saw that list of schools. We scratched off one of them, but there are still other schools on our waiting list that are waiting to get fed. And we're obviously hoping to continue to grow our online social media presence via digital ads. So we ask people to like our Facebook page, like our Instagram feed. Well, I don't know what it's called, but an Instagram account or something, I don't know. Go to our Instagram account and hit follow. I think that's what you do. And then just spread the word. Tell people about the opportunity to feed a child for $1 a week. We ask people for $5 a month to feed a child. So it's something everybody can do. It's something we have even children that are sponsoring kids, that are feeding kids through their allowance, through their lawn mowing, through their whatever they do. So it's really something that we've been able to invite everybody into. There's nobody that can't do $5 a month. You just don't have one Starbucks latte a month and you can feed a child. So I think that, does that get us to the end? Yep. Thank you very much, Bridgepoint, for making a huge impact in the lives of 128 children across the world. You guys are awesome. Thank you so much. I'll be out in the lobby if I can answer any questions.
That's awesome. Thanks so much. Yeah, like Brandon said, he's going to be out in the lobby afterwards. So, you know, we were talking on the phone, and this was maybe a month or so ago, and just their heart is that, you know, we're helping feed, but again, we love to be able to send teams over there and to be able to see. I think he talked about a church who went over and realized that kids were having to walk, you know, a mile away from the school just to go to the bathroom, and then that church was able to partner and help build a bathroom on campus at the school. And so the food is kind of the entryway into a greater level of partnership with them. To find out more, he'll be in the lobby after service. The third partnership that we have, you guys, if you've been at Bridgepoint for a while, you know that we have some missionaries serving over in Southeast Asia, and so they actually sent us a little bit of a video update, and so here's a message from Trey and Maddie Kasem.
Hey, Bridgepoint.
Hey, y'all. I'm Trey.
And I'm Maddie.
And we live in Southeast Asia doing sustainable development work with rural communities.
Well, can you tell us a little bit more about that? What's that
sure.
look like?
We walk communities through a process whereby they identify both their challenges and their resources to help them solve those challenges that are facing the community. And we normally focus on five areas, and that's food, water, income generation, education, and health.
One of the things that I love about working with these communities is the partners that you meet and the relationships that you form. And one of the things we want to share with you that happened recently is we partnered with a local community in northern Thailand, and we helped them build a water filtration system in their community so that they could have clean water for the first time. It was really exciting to see them get clean water. Our partner there is super happy, and he even met us in a nearby village that wasn't even his to bring us a whole bottle of the clean water that this system has produced. And why don't you tell us a little bit more, Trey, about the system and what you love about it?
So our goal when we're working in communities is not that we would be the hero, but that we could help empower the community to solve their own challenges. And so that applies to this water filtration system in that
the community used resources that they could find locally, like sand, rocks, and then we helped them make a special type of charcoal that can also filter out things like chemicals in addition to pathogens. So what's exciting about working with the community is that because they helped us build it, they understand how it works, which means they can maintain it and they can teach others how to build it as well. And that's preferable because when you use local resources, it keeps things simple and cheap. It's easy to maintain, teach others how to do. And in the end, the locals feel empowered. They feel like, I know how to do this. I believe that we're able to do this. I was an important part of building this system.
And one of the exciting things that Trey shared is the multiplication piece, that they're going to be able to do this and replicate it on their own in different communities. And so hopefully this year and the next couple of months, we'll see more filtration systems being put in or other projects being tackled that the community prioritizes.
So thank you, Bridgepoint, for supporting us both financially and through prayer as we try to bring transformational community development to communities all across Southeast Asia, both physically and spiritually.
Bye, Bridgepoint. Thank
Bye,
you.
Awesome. And I was actually on the phone with Trey this week, and it's been pretty amazing to see some of the work that they've been doing, because now they talked about a little bit. Now that the one community has built their own water filtration system, now they're going around and those people are helping the other surrounding communities. So it's multiplying out. And I love that, because when you look at whether it's Destino del Reino in Honduras, No Hungry Children over in Kenya, or GHNI serving over in Southeast Asia, they're noticing all of these little pockets of chaos and disorder, right? Where kids don't have access to education or clothing, or they don't have access to food. Where there's people who, I mean, literally they're relying on the spirits to clean their water. And Trey and Maddie get to go in and help them tackle issues like that. They're seeing all the disorder, and they're going in and they're bringing order. They're bringing heaven to earth. And because of your giving, we're able to partner with them on their mission. But, you know, so far it's been about awareness, but what about action? What kind of things can we walk away here today that we can tangibly partner with them? I'm going to give you three things. The first one is this: we need to be praying for each of these organizations and each of these people. Like, we don't just want to be the church that gives our money and says, here you go, you go do the work, but we believe in the power of prayer. And as they're doing frontline work, they need all the prayer that they can get, covering for them personally, for their families, for the villages and neighborhoods and slums that are being affected. Like, we just want to cover them in prayer. The second thing is, you want to give, you know, just like Brandon said, $5 a month. You know, it doesn't have to be anything great. All of these organizations are organizations that, yes, we give financially to as a church, but my wife and I, we partner with these organizations as well. That's how much we believe in them. And it doesn't have to be a massive amount, but even a little bit helps. And so we'd encourage you to begin to think, and as you're praying, God, is there a way you want me to financially partner with these organizations above and beyond even what we're doing here at Bridgepoint? And then the last one is go. You know, as your pastor, my heart, I want to give you kind of the big picture vision and then how that applies to you. We are working towards a plan where once a year we'd be able to send a team to each one of our partners over the course of the year. And as your pastor, it's my heart for you that at least one time in your life you would go on a mission trip to somewhere else. And the goal is not so that you go and you can come back and feel so thankful that you don't have to live like that. And the goal is not, like Trey said, to go and for us to be the hero. But the reason I want you to go is because I want you to see the work that our partners are doing, and maybe that stirs a passion in your heart I think some of you are here today, and God may be stirring a passion for you to move somewhere, for you to go and to be on the front lines of ministry. And man, we won't know that until we have the opportunity to go. And that looks different with each and every one of these partners. And you can talk to Brandon about what that might look like there. I know in Honduras, they have a sports camp that they had a church doing for years over the summer, and they're looking for somebody to step in the gap and fill that need. I know Trey and Maddie even have already asked, can we send a team out in November? And I said, I don't know if we have the ramp up time yet, but they're just, they want to show people the work that they're up to, and we get to be a part of that. And so we're going to continue and worship this morning like we do every week through a time of communion. And so we have our communion stations around the room. And here's what I want to ask you to do. As you spend time with Jesus, I want you to pray. Pray for each of our partners. And then pray and ask God, what does a next step look like for me? Maybe he'll just tell you it just is a daily routine of praying for them. Maybe he's calling you to give something. Maybe he's calling you to go, and maybe that needs to be the life group you lead in the fall as a team prepping to go somewhere in November or December. I don't know what that looks like for you, but I know I have a next step that I'm praying through right now, and I believe each of us here does as well. So would you bow your heads and close your eyes with me? Jesus, we're so thankful that you have plans to rescue and redeem and restore this broken world. And I'm thankful that you've called us to be a part of that. And as daunting and as scary and as overwhelming as that can sometimes be, I just pray you would give us eyes to see how we can bring heaven to earth every single day. And we just pray right now for Destino, for No Hungry Children, for GHNI. Just pray that you would continue to strengthen them and use them to make it a tangible difference here and now. God, I pray that when the world thinks about your followers, that's what they see. They see us being your hands and feet, that you get all the glory, and that heaven comes to earth. Help us to be more like you. It's in your name I pray. Amen. You can take communion as you feel led.